Hello, everybody. I am indeed Michael. These are my details. My Twitter name is Acton, if you want to digitally heckle me during the speech, or you can always grab me afterwards. So I set up a game studio called Mind Candy a few years ago, and we've had one hit game, a monster hit called Moshi Monsters, which has been a huge amount of fun to build and took us by surprise. And I'm just curious to know how many of you in the audience have played Moshi or been on the site. Okay, a handful, not bad. It's designed for 7 to 11-year-olds, but you're all obviously very welcome to play as well. Lots of kids at heart, good to see. But we encourage grandparents and parents and anyone that wants to come along and play. For those that don't know, it's essentially the world of adoptable pet monsters, sort of a cross between Tamagotchi and Facebook for kids. I'm going to start with a graph just before we dive into everything. So this is Moshi Monsters and some of our characters. And we launched it we put it live at the end of 2007. And then we went live with our beta in sort of about April 2009. And then something bizarre happened, and I'm going to talk about it more during my speech, in the summer of 2009. We launched our subscription service at the start of that year, and a couple of months later, the game had reached cash flow positive, and we're profitable, and we've basically been trying to hold on for dear life ever since, and we're now well over 25,000 registered users, adding about one new registered user every second. And it's one of the fastest growing kids sites in the world. It's also one of the fastest growing internet properties in the world, adding over 20 million users in a year. Now, that's all very interesting and exciting, and there's few things more boring than someone getting on stage and telling you how wonderful their business is. So what I want to do today is kind of give you the story behind the graph, to talk about all the stuff that went to get to this point, the blood, the sweat, and the tears. We launched a lot of stuff that worked. We also did a lot of stupid stuff and screwed up and made plenty of mistakes. So during my speech today, I want to share with you 10 of the key lessons that we learnt on this exciting journey. And I hope that some of these lessons will be valuable for you guys, because I know there are plenty of people very excited about the online gaming space and many people in this audience building online games, not just in the kids space, but in the grown-up space as well. So before we dive in and get to all the juicy stuff, just one step backwards. When I launched Mind Candy, the first game we created was something called Perplex City, an alternate reality game where we buried a £100,000 treasure and then we released clues across different types of media. We used websites and mobile phones, and we released a music album and magazines. We had actors at live events, we had helicopters. We went pretty crazy. And we'd raised $10 million of venture finance to launch this business. There were a lot of hopes riding on us. And unfortunately, it didn't work. It was a bit of an interesting case study. We won a lot of awards, we got a lot of buzz. I was always had lots of people wanting to chat to me at dinner parties, but the game just didn't really resonate with our audience, or any audience, and it was just too complex. And we learned a lot of lessons from it, and one of the key things we learned was that it's okay to fail. You know, our investors weren't too impressed and didn't really want to hear me saying that. But it's okay to fail as long as you fail quickly and you learn from your mistakes. Don't do what we did, which was to take 3 years to realize Perplex City wasn't going to work and burn our way through $9 million of venture finance. So rather than throwing in the towel, we still had a little bit of cash left, and we decided to have one more roll of the dice with Mind Candy. And I'd always been fascinated by the category of virtual pets. I used to run a company called Firebox and had been to trade shows around the world. And virtual pets are a really big part of the toy industry. Kids love nurturing and looking after little characters. And in a coffee shop one day after too much coffee, I sketched this out a few years ago. And I was just thinking about how we could make virtual pets more interesting, more emotionally resonant, more social, as broadband was taking off and flash technologies were increasing, improving. I thought there was an interesting opportunity here. And the virtual pet space has grown and evolved as technology has advanced, all the way back in the 70s to the pretty low-tech Pet Rock, which, for those that haven't seen it, is a rock, and it's your pet, and it comes with an instruction manual and a cute little box and some straw. Then we've had Beanie Babies and Tamagotchis and Furbies and Nintendogs and Neopets and Webkins. And as I say, we wanted to do something new, something a little bit different. And that was the starting point to Moshi Monsters. So I just want to quickly show, for those that don't know, how the game works. You adopt a monster, you fill in the adoption papers, you choose your monster's color, and then your little monster lives in its room. And the key part of the game, the one that I'm most excited about, is something called the Puzzle Palace. This is a very important engagement loop that keeps children playing and coming back to the site. So we were originally going to call the game Puzzle Monsters, and the teachers we spoke to loved that idea. The parents loved it, but the kids hated it. They didn't like the idea of learning when they had got home from school. But I didn't want to lose that element of the game, so we decided to weave it in underneath the fun gameplay stuff. And we call it stealth education. So in the Puzzle Palace, there are 35 different puzzles that kids can do, everything from anagrams to general knowledge to word searches and logic. And depending on how they do, they win rocks, which is the in-game currency that they can then go and spend in the world. And one of the fun anecdotes I heard from a friend of mine, she was in New York recently with her daughter, her five-year-old daughter, and they were walking along a street, and her daughter was mentioning countries as they walked. Spain and France and Peru and Germany, and they looked at her and asked what she was doing, and they realized she was pointing at the flags outside a hotel, and they were flabbergasted, and she was naming flags that they didn't even know, and she told them that she'd learnt this by playing the flag game on Moshi Monsters, which I think is great, and lots of other examples of that, of kids learning stuff and impressing their parents with long words and whatnot outside of the school environment. So, as I mentioned, kids do their puzzles and then they get their rocks and they can go shopping. And for many, this is the most fun part of the game. They can go and buy food at the grocery store. They can go to Yakia if they want to buy some furniture. Horrids, if they've got a lot of rocks, to buy the expensive stuff. We like our puns. They can go dancing in the underground disco to Lady Gugu or the Gronus Brothers. Simon Growl rates them afterwards and gives them a score, and then they have their room and they can customize it exactly as they want with items and clothing and elements to show off their personality and express themselves. We even have our own kind of Farmville element where kids have a garden and they can plant seeds in their garden, and if they get the right combination of seeds, they attract what's called a little moshling. And this surprised us. This is a very, very popular part of the game. They're almost like digital Pokemon, little characters from the very common Chop Chop, the cheeky chimp, through to Iggy down in the bottom right-hand corner. And kids can capture these moshlings and show them off in their rooms. And if they've got rare ones, they get more visitors to their room and more comments and so forth. And each little character has its own bio and backstory. And it's, as I say, been very, very popular. So I mentioned we put the first slice of Moshi out. It was actually in very late 2007. And we were racking our brain back then about how on earth we could monetize this fun game we were building. And we'd seen something that was doing incredibly well at the time called Webkins, where you buy a plush toy and it has a code around its neck. And we thought that sounds like a good model to copy or be inspired by. And we created something called Moshi Monsters Mopods, which are phone charms that spin when you get a phone message. And in every phone charm, there was a unique code that allowed you to adopt a pet online at Moshi. And we thought it was a brilliant idea. And we spoke to retailers and distributors, and no one had heard of us. No one took the product. There was no demand from consumers because there was no one playing on Moshi Monsters. In hindsight, it was a pretty stupid idea. So this was second important lesson: don't blindly follow the market leader. And there's so much example of this, not just in the games industry, in every industry. There's a hit, World of Warcraft, Farmville, whatever, and then everyone piles in and tries to do the same. You need a twist, you need to pivot and come at it with a different angle. So with Moshi, we've come at it with a different angle. It's still aimed at kids, there's still mini games and other elements, but we focus more on the community and the social side. And when Club Penguin was bought by Disney a couple of years ago, there was an absolute stampede into the kids' space. A lot of money, a lot of talent flowed in, and most people just tried to copy Club Penguin. They created a very similar play pattern, and very, very few, if any, have worked. So I think this is a really, really important lesson. Now, the toy industry in the US alone is worth $20 billion. And so far, we've only seen a handful of websites catering for kids and only a few different play patterns catered for. But when you look offline and you realize everything from Barbie to Hot Wheels to Cabbage Patch Dolls, there's so many different play patterns and experiences for kids online. So I think we're going to see a lot more successful kids' properties emerge over the next year or two. I think it's a very exciting space. So we learned something really valuable from this. We decided, instead of forcing users to buy a physical product and get a code and access our game, we thought we'd just open it up and make it free and figure out how to make money down the line. And lo and behold, it was a big, big success. The day that we put that live on the 14th of April, we went from about 5 signups a day to almost 5,000 signups a day, which after years of slaving away with mind candy and migraine-inducing board meetings, we suddenly felt there was a glimmer of hope here that we could be onto something. And throughout that year, 2008, the site grew and got bigger and bigger, and we were adding more and more free users, but we still hadn't cracked that problem of how we were going to make money. So we decided to add a subscription service, freemium. And so as wonderful as that year was, adding loads and loads of free features, we had to address the important problem of the meme bit. We created our velvet rope and gave extra content, extra games, extra items, extra kudos to the members within Moshi Monsters for about £5 a month. And we created a Moshi Monsters passport for those users. And we realized in all our tinkering and figuring out what to make free and what to put behind the velvet rope, there were two elements that were most successful when considering subscription-only features. The first was that they needed to be sliced. And what I mean by that is we wanted to create membership features that all users could experience and taste and get a sense of how they worked, but then withhold the cooler parts of it for the paying members. The second element was that the membership features needed to be visual. There's no point having an ultra cool item if no one else can see it and you can't show it off. And even in the grown-up space, the most successful sites that are monetizing well with freemium subscription models are those that have social features, so you can see what the other users are doing and figure out that you want to become a member too. So we're now heading towards the end of 2008. We're figuring out these membership features that we want to put into the game, but we haven't launched it yet. We still have no revenue. We've got reasonable growth, but then we hit a pretty serious problem. The money that we had left over after Perplex City was dwindling. We were very, very short on cash, and we needed to raise another round. Unfortunately, 2008, towards the end, was probably the worst time ever to try and raise venture capital. And if you're ever in this situation, don't even bother. Just go and sit on a beach somewhere and wait till it all blows over. No one wanted anything to do with us. It was a very, very painful time. December 08, we were running on vapors. Cash was practically out. We couldn't even afford to make payroll at the end of that month. And we were desperately trying to find someone just to put in a little bit of cash so we could limp over into the next month where we were going to launch these subscription features. Fortunately, we found an angel that took pity on us and put in a little bit of cash, and our existing investors put in a little bit as well. And we limped over into January, and we crossed our fingers and hoped that parents would be willing to pay for our membership features. And amazingly, they were. And it was a hugely exciting time. So I know this is incredibly obvious, but revenue really does solve a lot of problems for a startup. You know, when you think about it, how many startups actually get to this point? Most never make a dime of revenue before going out of business. It's not just good because it keeps your bank manager happy and your investors happy and solves cash flow problems and whatnot, but I think the most important point is the psychological shift that happens in your company once consumers are ready to pay for your product. It's a massive shift. You've hit product market hit, and people are willing to get their wallet open and pay for this product you've been crafting and slaving away for. So this was a very, very exciting time for us. And this is one of the most important pages on our site, obviously crafting a wonderfully fun game experience. But we need to pay for our rent and our salaries and so forth. So we spend a lot of time thinking about this page. And anyone in digital subscription or building online games or any product should do also.